beautiful dead tree. It's an old knob thorn in the frame with it. And what a lovely way to start the morning. My name is Byron, and on camera with me this morning is Dave. On the other vehicle, you probably would have seen Taylor doing the pre-show drive. She's with Brian. And then we've got Louise and Kirsten in final control. It's great to have all of you with us. As I said, we have got technical issues, so I cannot hear anything from Louise at the moment in final control. We will still try to get through your questions and your comments. We're probably going to communicate with our phones, which is not ideal because there might be a bit of a delay, but we'll do our best and we'll fix it hopefully soon. And but what a great way to start the morning with the sunrise. It really is fantastic. And we've been sitting here for about 10 minutes or 15 minutes just enjoying the sun coming up, listening to all the bird calls. It really has been an incredible morning. We had some ground hornbills fly over us, which was great. We heard them calling. They flew over us and they headed off into the east. So I think what we're going to do this morning is, my plan is to try and find leopard. Possibly go and head down to where Karula left her cubs yesterday, and she left them in a bit of a drainage line and a culvert. So we're going to go see if maybe she went and fetched them. Who knows? She may have killed something, took the cubs to the kill. So we're going to head down there, see what we can find. And while we do that, Taylor, I think, is looking for lions. So she's going to be wandering around, and hopefully we'll find some lions this morning. We did hear them calling early this morning, and it sounded also like further in the east, but from what I heard, it sounded quite far. So this is going to be interesting, everyone, without the questions rolling in on a regular basis, then I'm going to have to make up a lot or think what questions you might have for us this morning. And I'm not too sure what the temperature is this morning. It's probably around 23 degrees Celsius, I would say. Dave, what do you think?
Sounds about right.
So I think that's around 76 to 78, possibly, somewhere around there. I think that's what the temperature is this morning. And that's, yeah, about 76, 78 Fahrenheit. 21 degrees Celsius and 70 Fahrenheit. I was close. That's all right. That's not too bad. So it's a nice cool morning. And while we're driving now, we've got a beautiful, beautiful cool breeze. And Taylor actually headed to that position where the lions were yesterday, and where they had the buffalo that they were feeding on. And apparently they've moved off. So not too sure where they have gone. They are looking for them. But she said they didn't feed on much of it, or they left a lot, which was interesting. Very, very interesting. And I do think that one of the reasons is probably because these lions are feeding so regularly that there's no need to stay with the carcass and finish a buffalo. I mean, it's a lot of meat there. But I think because they're feeding daily, they really are. These lions have been incredibly successful over the last little while, the last 2 weeks, I would say. So they're feeding on a regular basis, so they're staying full. So there's no need to necessarily stay with the kill and finish it completely. I'm going to constantly have to check my phone, everyone, just to see if Louise does send us a message with questions or anything. Don't forget, everyone, we are completely live and it's very interactive. So send us your questions either through Twitter at #SafariLive, otherwise email us questions@wildearth.tv, and we'll gladly answer your questions, and we love hearing from our viewers. And we've got a beautiful herd of impala wandering around here. Look at this, all these pregnant females. Off to our right, some big bellies there. So So very soon we're going to start having some Impala lambs, and there's some Inyala. Inyala with the Impala, and it's almost too early to try and say that quickly. Anyway, while we continue and these Impala feed on their breakfast, let's head over to Taylor so she may say good morning and find out what she's up to.
Hello and welcome, and sorry again about all the little technical difficulties we're having this morning, but we shall not let that get us down. Now, of course, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me, we'll give you another little look. We've got Brian and the Thumb. There is the Thumb. Isn't he wonderful? Such a good-looking Thumb. Is he smart again today, suit and tie?
Yeah, a little tired.
Oh, look at those bags under his eyes. Oh, no. Needs some caffeine in his system. Well, perhaps we shall brew some pods from the weeping bird bean. What do you think, Brian? Give the Thumb some coffee. I don't know how much caffeine it has in now. Now, I hope you're all enjoying all the dramas that are going on this morning and the saga of the life in the African wilderness. I think it's quite fantastic. It sort of stirs things up a little bit. Now, I'm still looking for those lines like I told you in the pre-drive drive, but I haven't seen any more sign, and Aubrey's of course helping me search for them, and we are doing an army sort of fan style where we're just going to check everywhere really. And of course, I'd like to find Daryl the elephant this morning. That's also going to be on the agenda. But for now, we're just really just cruising around. Well, remember, if you have perhaps just joined us, welcome. And this is a live safari that you're watching at the moment. If you'd like to chat to Byron or myself, you're welcome to either hashtag Safari Live, or you can even send us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. Now, unfortunately, we haven't quite established communication just yet, so we're still using these wonderful devices to just chat to the lovely ladies in Final Control. So every now and then you shall see me checking my cellular device, really. Oh, we have a question. Now I need to read the question. This is lovely. Good morning, Judy H. Have you seen the close encounter videos that Wild had with Daryl the elephant? I think I have. I think actually Louise showed me as I arrived. And I found that quite interesting. Naughty Daryl, that. You've got to be careful with him. But luckily for me, he was always quite kind to me. And I spent at least a couple of hours with him every day. Sometimes on game drive, he would join me in sightings, or I'd find him. And of course, I'd make an effort to go up and say hello. Otherwise, what else did he do? He used to visit us at the swimming pool and our staff accommodation. He loved that. He came there for a drink once a day if he wasn't harassing the guests at the lodge. He loved to eat all the succulents out of the garden, out of the Zen garden. So he was constantly between the spa, the wellness center, and of course the lodge. And it was interesting because it meant that the guests needed to be escorted around a lot because he wasn't afraid, but he also wasn't particularly bothered by people. So if you gave him a bit of room, he could walk past and he wouldn't even turn and look at you, can be a bit nerve-wracking, especially for the guests, because I think sometimes people would get this false sense of security, and we were always worried that somebody was going to push their luck and try and get too close, and then, well, you know, he's a big elephant, he probably stands at about 5 tons at least, he's quite large. Well, then that would be a problem, of course. But he never ever gave us any problems as far as I'm aware. So we could probably go back to around towards the gate and have a look and see if we can find him. Now, at the moment, there doesn't seem to be any animals around. We're searching. And we'll also be looking for any leopard tracks or any footprints of any animals of interest. But nothing so far. We did see a couple of ground hornbills, though, flying around this morning, but they flew away. They obviously got what they needed and then off they went. Now I'm just trying to get a game plan I'm trying to figure out where these lions have gone. Now, you've obviously been hearing us chatting about these animals and we have names for them, and I know that Melinda was wondering, how do the animals get names? So Melinda, There's no sort of set process, especially with things like the elephants or an impala that's got one horn. We just give them little comical names and stuff. Daryl, for example, this was a different story. Daryl lived outside a set of guests that I had. He lived outside their room for 3 days and they absolutely loved him. Now, I don't know what they're thinking of, where the name Daryl came from. We did have one of the chefs, his name was Daryl, so I don't know if they named him after Daryl the chef. But he just got that name, and then, well, he's been around for many, many years, and people have been seeing him for a very long time, and that he didn't have a name. And this name is really now just stuck, and everybody calls him Daryl, except up here. I think James needs a little bit of convincing, but perhaps if he gets to know him as well as I do, he'll see that really he is a Daryl. I don't know if I could call him anything else. Anyway, let's see. Now, I'm just trying to think. We might just quickly do a little check along the boundary, perhaps, if Byron hasn't already done that. And the reason for that is, well, we don't know where Karula went. I know Byron said he wanted to try and follow up on Karula. So perhaps we'll go towards Triple M, back towards the gate, so still keeping Daryl in our plan. And then maybe we will check for Shadow. I can't remember exactly where Shadow is or was. I just remember that she was just off of Triple M. But I don't know if she'll still be there. That was a very small kill that she had, and I'm sure that she ate the rest of it last night. But we will check. Maybe we'll see her footprints or something along those lines. Right, just reading another question quickly. Now, of course, as you know, I'm very much fond of the Nkuhumas and my favorite little girl with the floppy ear. Now, Jason was wondering if I knew that that little cub had been named Flip Flop. Now, Byron, I don't know if Flip Flop is a deserving name, so I'm trying to find out what the Shangaan word or Tsonga word for sort of naughty or cheeky, mischievous, because I think that describes her very well, and her personality, or feisty, something along those lines. So I did ask Amanda, our wonderful chef who cooks all the delicious food for us, and she told me a name, but I've forgotten it now, so I shall have to write it down and then let you know. And it sounded quite cool. It sounded something like along the lines of almost Delilah, which I thought was quite nice, but it's obviously a Shangaan word. It's not that, and I'm not going to try and pronounce it because I know James will get very upset with me if I do something like that and I don't get it pronounced correctly. So I'm just checking. No more questions just yet. Right. Let's see what we've got around over here. You know what we've been actually seeing a lot of lately? Oh, hello, Jigger, and your fantastic squeaky brakes, is these dung piles from the elephants. I just wanted to show you. Look at that, and that's beautiful because it's got the lovely golden light at the moment. Ooh. Hi. Just turn my game drive radio off. Now, isn't that the most well-backlit dung pile you've ever seen in your life? Now, I just want to tell you, normally we see these little balls of dung. And you can see that the dung beetles have been working their magic, coming out in the summer months and turning it from a big ball into these sort of long, flat piles of dung. And over time, eventually, this will completely disappear. And I just think it's so interesting how that in the, sorry, there's an elephant walking down the road to us and I got excited, but it's not Daryl. So in the summer months, of course, you've got the dung beetles and the termites working very hard. But of course, the termites really take over the role in the winter months. Look at this beautiful elephant bull. Let's go and position ourselves. Sadly, it's not Daryl, but I think we can have a quick look at him. Maybe he's seen Daryl. Perhaps it's Daryl's cousin or a younger brother. We'll never really know. We'll just give him lots of room and wait for him. I'm just going to drop down. Now, I've got a bit of a tree in the way, but he'll probably just walk past us, but we'll give him a bit of space. It's always good to give these animals space. Now, he's not nearly as big as Daryl. You can see his tusks are much smaller. But he's relatively big in size, but I think he's much younger. So I reckon he's probably just coming into his 30s. He seems mature. You can see the secretion coming from his temporal glands. Now, that could also be an indication that he's possibly coming into mast. It doesn't look like it, though. I don't see any sort of staining between his back legs. But that also shows an overstimulation of adrenaline. So it could be that he's stressed. It could be that he's excited. So I'm just going to sit up here. Hello, big boy. And we'll see what he gets up to. Hi, big man. It's okay, big boy. How are you this morning? He's a gentle giant. Hey, big boy. No, not today. Thank you. You can just carry on with your day. He's so big that Brian can't even fit him into shot. Isn't that amazing? Oh, and you know what? He's coming into mast. As he walked past like that, it's still the very, very early stages, though. So you're right. He was very relaxed with us. He just had a little look. And I think what happens is that because we've got this big antenna on the back of the vehicle, is that often these animals get a little bit, not a fright, but they're like, oh, what's that? Oh, okay, it's not moving. It's okay. But as he walked past us and we got the wind blowing back down towards us, I got this very, very musky smell. So I think it's the very early stages. Perhaps in the next couple of weeks or so, he's going to be in full mast. And then, well, we'll be keeping away from him. So we won't follow him and harass him anymore. Let's just check to see what Louise would like to do. Okay, so we'll leave him. Bye, Mr. Elephant. And that was fantastic and lovely. And he walked away. Didn't show any signs of aggression. It's quite nice. And of course, well, I've now got the stench of that musty smell up my nose. What about you, Brian? But you quite like that smell, don't you? Yes, Brian's told me a couple of times that you've enjoyed it. I wondered, does the thumb enjoy it?
No, always.
Always. This is actually the thumb's favorite smell, musk. Now, of course, not must. It's a musky smell, but they go into must. Let's go this way. Perhaps we'll go check around here. We're really just having a little check and driving. I think Byron's probably looking at some tracks. That's always a nice way to start the day. Seeing a lovely elephant bull. I'm also going to just check here. Oh my goodness, I've heard a little voice in my ear. That must mean that the radio is working. Let me just turn that down a little bit. It was very loud. Wonderful. Isn't that exciting that after all this time, finally, we're back up in action and in working order again. Well, that's exciting. Well done, Connor, who I'm pretty sure has fixed the problem, whatever it may have been. So kudos to you. But now I can also put my cell phone down, which is quite refreshing because it felt very strange sort of trying to drive and talk. And I mean, it's one thing trying to do it on the highways at 120 kilometers an hour or however fast you'd like to travel. But I even find it challenging to try and do that when we're only just going a couple of kilometers an hour. Did you see something, Brian? Now, where is everyone else? Animals must wake up. Oh, put my clip back in my hair. Oh, let's turn the game drive radio on. I can hear someone is talking. Let's see what they have to say. I've got a... It seems as though they're talking about leopards, and I know that Byron is going to be on the leopards this morning, so perhaps he's listening. We're going to continue looking for what we've set out today, and we're not going home until we find Daryl or the Nkuhumas this morning. I've made up my mind. Louise, did you hear that? I'm not stopping until those animals are found. Louise is fantastic. Okay. Now we need to get serious. And it was lots of sort of animals going around. Just as we were driving through quarantine, there was a whole herd of elephants that had seemed to have gone through there last night. Hippopotamus and buffalo and zebra and of course the impala. It was all happening on quarantine last night. Let's see if they're still talking about leopard. There's still lots of talking going on.
Copy, thank you.
Yeah. Let's see any updates on the Nkrumahs. Okay, copy. Oh, what was that? No, wrong radio. Whew. Sorry, I'm being attacked by flies as we're driving along. Now, I heard these babblers, but they've gone quiet now. Oh, there they are. They're so sneaky. Look at that beautiful sky anyway. The babblers are quite quick, but they're hopping around making lots and lots of noise. I thought we should maybe try and stop and say hello to them. Here we go, you can see them bouncing around. Making, like I said, much noise, which is why they're of course called babblers. Shouting about, there's an entire flock of them flying around here, and they're probably doing that to declare their territory. They're quite territorial birds. You often see them chasing all sorts of other things away. Now, Clay from Oregon, you were asking this morning if I thought that, if I thought that there were more animals early in the morning. Is that correct, Louise? Sorry, I got very distracted by the babblers. Ah. Yes, sorry, Clay. So you were wondering if the animals are waking up earlier in the morning or are they late risers? Now, it's quite an amazing balance that the animals just sort of go, oh, a black-bellied bustard. I'll get your question, I promise. I'm just getting so distracted by the birds. Look at this. Hello? Is it or is it a... Oh, my goodness. Now I'm getting confused between them and the red-crested coron. But it looks like a bustard. Very, very obviously prominent black belly. And also the marking on the back of the head. But let me just double-check myself because now I can't... I have to be 100% sure, of course, and I feel as though I haven't seen these birds in such a long time. Yes, it is. I'm correct. But it's always good to double check yourself. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. And this is a male. Now, it's quite easy to tell that it's a male. You see that marking on the back of its head? That black and the white, the very prominent white. That's very typical. The females aren't quite as colorful. Now, won't you do your call for us? Because that would be quite special. And it just seems to have woken up and sort of feeding. So, sorry, Clay, let me get back to your question again. Now, I definitely think that at the moment, it's like at 4 o'clock almost, I'm starting to hear the birds all chatting away and waking up. And of course, oh, look, watch. Oh, did you see that? It's doing its call. Normally we just hear it. It's not very often that you actually get to see it. That was beautiful. Oh, well, and that definitely confirms that it's a black-bellied bustard, the fact that it sounds like a champagne cork popping out of the bottle. Let's see if he does it again. I think he may. So I think as he's going through here, he's also perhaps scouring for a female to try and impress. But calling is a way of advertising that he is in the area, and this area is occupied. Now that would be an amazing nest to find. So Clay, we will try this for a fourth time now. Oh, breakfast. As the birds wake up, they do that beautiful call, the chorus, of course. It's starting to get earlier and earlier, but it does continue, like I can still hear the birds still going. And that normally signals to sort of start the clock again. And I reckon that the other animals hear this, and I think that's almost when That light just starts to rise at first light before the sun has even peered over the horizon. The aardvark and the porcupine and all the other nocturnal creatures then start to descend and go back to their homes and sort of go and rest. And then we'll wait again until the next chorus. And then, well, the whole process starts again. Impala, kudu, most of them are all up before we are even up, just before the first light. They're all already up and feeding away, which is quite nice. It's really just at the middle of the night that you could catch them sleeping for a little bit, but they don't rest for too long. Right, I believe that Byron is back in his vehicle and ready to go. So let's go across and say good morning again.
Good morning again, Taylor. We are back in the vehicle. I did see tracks of Karula and her two cubs, everyone. I'm checking this area very, very carefully and trying to see. It looks like she headed north further onto Juma. But I'm having a look along this road, and if I don't see anything coming out, probably going to head back towards those tracks and maybe track a little bit. But look what is in front of us here. Beautiful giraffe. And I can hear the ground hornbills, everyone. Remember I said when we started the show, I told you that they flew over us this morning. And I can hear them now. They've probably landed somewhere. And let's see if we can hear them. Let's see if we can hear them. Can you hear them at all, I wonder? But too far, I think, just out of earshot for you. How beautiful is this giraffe? We had that lovely silhouette earlier. It's the nice silhouette of a giraffe against the sunrise. It really makes for a wonderful, wonderful picture. And I enjoy photographing silhouetted giraffe. There's a cacophony of bird calls going on at the moment. There are hornbills, there are Franklins, there are ground hornbills, there's starlings. There's so much going on at the moment, so many bird calls. It really is fantastic. It's a beautiful morning. It's so nice, so refreshing, because it's still got quite that cool temperature, so it really is fantastic. Oh, a little slender mongoose just ran across the road. X-Ranger said if I am ever at a loss for something to say, I should just do a bird impression. I'll remember that. Thank you, X-Ranger. So while I'm driving now, I'm having a close look at the road for any signs of the female's tracks or Karula's tracks with the cubs. We'd think it would be easy to spot three leopard tracks, but alas, it is not. But we'll see what we come up with. I enjoy this tracking, trying to work out where did these animals go during the evening. Did they hunt? Were they successful? So it is very, very exciting, and it builds up the anticipation of potentially finding these leopards, who we know are very secretive and who are not easy to find. I'm hoping that some of the other animals help us. Maybe we get alarm calls from impala or birds, squirrels, you never know. Anything like that alarm calls will help alert us to where these leopards are. And if I find them, I will be very, very happy this morning. Sorry, and then of course, your eyes start playing tricks on you when you're looking for something specific. And you think you see something that's not really there, but It's always, and I always say this to guests, because often we'd be driving, guests go, you know, stop, they've seen something. And have a look, and it ends up being perhaps a log or a little termite mound. It looks like something lying in the grass. And they're very apologetic, but there's nothing to apologize for. It's a case of, if you don't really have a look, you might miss something. So never say sorry if you think you've spot something and it's not that. And Jeremiah, you would like to know, what is the strangest animal I've seen during a safari? The strangest... let me think. So just scanning around, there are a lot of impala dotted around this area, so I highly doubt Karula is walking through this area with her cubs. They'd most likely alarm call and give us a clue that she was around. Jeremiah, strangest animal I've ever seen. Does James count? No, I'm joking. Strangest animal on a safari. I would say an aardvark or a pangolin. Now those aardvarks, you know, it's also known as ant bears in some areas, but the aardvark, let me show you a picture quickly. So let me stop here and just show you, because they are very strange, and they do look quite weird. So let me see if I can find a picture of one quickly for you. There we go. Look at that animal. Isn't that strange? Long ears, long pointed snout. So for us here in Africa, this is one of the strangest animals. Well, I mean... I suppose it's all relative, I don't know, but it's because they are so rare, so you don't see them very often. I've been fortunate, I've guided people in another area, another part of South Africa, where these are, I wouldn't say common, but the chances of seeing them are very, very good. And we've seen, I've seen quite a few aardvark, which is really nice, but that's probably the strangest animal I've seen. That and the little pangolin, the little scaly anteater. They also look quite prehistoric, so I'd have to say those two animals, but I think the aardvark wins a little bit. Still don't see any signs of these leopards coming through this area. But we're going to carry on searching very, very carefully. I'd love to find Karula this morning. And see what she got up during the evening. I know she did leave those cubs, but when we got back there now, I saw their tracks around there, so they were moving. And I did take a walk, didn't see any sign of them, so... But I'm probably going to head back down there and quickly have a look and see where those tracks go. While I do that, Taylor's got some more elephant for you to see.
Now, our plan is to also just keep checking every single elephant that we're going to see today and make sure if it's Daryl or not. Now, unfortunately, this is not Daryl. He's not big enough in body size, and he hasn't got big enough tusks either. And this is a different one from what we saw earlier. There's actually a couple here. It looks like there's about 5 elephant bulls on quarantine, so we're going to have a look. We'll have a quick look now. And then we're going to move forward. I just want to see something. I've just seen a bird that's caught my attention. Brian, that marula, that's straight down there. Can you see on the left at the bottom of the tree, there's a little bird? Now, I think it might be a roller. I think it was a roller. It is. Okay. It was a roller. I got excited because I heard it making a strange noise, and I wondered if it wasn't one of the cuckoos as it was flying. But it isn't. You can see it's a lilac-breasted roller waking up. Looking for some breakfast today. Good morning. And of course, warming up in that sun as well, which birds often like to do. It was quite chilly last night. I even had to put a jersey on when I walked down to the vehicles this morning, which is unusual, as it's been so hot. It's either been no jersey or a rain jacket. But yes, it's going to be very hot again today. But should we go and check the next elephants? I think so. Let's, because I'm very excited now. We're going to go around the corner. Like I said, there's an entire, there's about five of them here. So we're one down. We've got four to go to check. Now, I don't know if I'm feeling too optimistic just yet. The reason why is because they don't look big enough. And I haven't seen any that have got particularly large tusks. I'm also just checking for lion tracks, but it doesn't look like it. We may have to go the long way around, I suspect. We'll try and have a look from this side, and if not, we'll go all the way around and check the boys. We just need to find a gap. Just pull off slightly. There's another elephant. That doesn't look like Daryl either. He hasn't got a bell shape in his ear, as you can see. And also, Daryl's tusks sort of point towards the ground. I don't know if you noticed that. They're quite straight. So hopefully as he gets bigger, they're going to almost reach the ground. Maybe he's got that beautiful genetic that brings out the lovely tusks. But they're very happily feeding at the moment, and it's nice to see the bulls. We've been seeing so many elephants, and of course in the breeding herds. We haven't seen any particularly large bulls. Now, I think out of the bulls I've seen so far, I think Daryl's going to be the biggest. And people, I don't think anyone really realizes how big he actually is. But let's go around again. We're going to go all the way around, I suspect. Or do you think it'll be quicker, Brian, if we go back this way? I think it'll be quicker, hey? Let's go. We'll go back the way we came so we can jump onto Vuyatela access. And I think they're quite close to that junction, somewhere around there. And we're just going to have to take it easy today. And luckily, now Taxon has also joined in on the search to try and find the lion. So that will give us an opportunity, of course, to search for Daryl. Oh, we can say a quick hello to a giraffe as well. It's all happening on quarantine this morning. Maybe it was the same one you saw with Byron. I'm not actually sure, but we'll say hello and have a quick look. Hello. This looks like a female. Of course, I'm able to tell that by the long black tufts of hair that you see on her ossy cones. Every time I think of that, I think of Byron. And apparently so does she. And she looks like she's got a rather sort of round belly. What do you think, Brian? Does look like she could have a little calf inside of it. Well, I suppose there's nothing really little about a giraffe calf. And this is something that I've actually been fortunate enough to see. I've seen a giraffe giving birth before. Can you believe it? When I first started studying to be a guide, I came across the corner. We were out on a drive in the morning, and we found this giraffe all on her own, and we thought she looked a bit sort of, she was behaving quite strange, and well, the next minute she started giving birth. And we sat there for about an hour and a half, and it was absolutely incredible. Then once the calf had dropped, the mother then started to clean the little one up. And what was even more incredible was as the little calf dropped, the rest of the herd came around. And unfortunately, I didn't have a camera in those days, and I didn't have a very good cell phone, so I couldn't really get any photos. We also kept our distance. And then they all came around, and they started licking the little one, and eventually it stood up and started walking. Isn't that amazing? I got to see the entire process. She seemed to have a little itch there. But not too itchy, just a quick scratch. Now, she's actually got quite a nice sort of vantage point here. You can see her scanning down into the distance. And as we know, the giraffe have got phenomenal eyesight. So perhaps there are a couple of other giraffe around here, and that's what she's looking for. Or maybe she's just looking for her next tree that she's going to feed on. Yes. Or maybe both. So she's feeding on a paper thorn acacia. Flaky thorn, not paper thorn. Now, Lilani, you're wondering what has been my favorite sighting. There's so many. I've had from, you know, being quite gory, with, of course, with the lions, to incredible things like seeing births, and, of course, amazing experiences with the elephants that have just been incredible. And I think I've told most of the elephant stories. I've got a couple more. Now, I'm just trying to think, what is my absolute favorite? I think it has to be, I'm going to actually say that sighting we had the other afternoon, when it was quite sad, of course, because that young buffalo calf was taken down, was the one that happened just above the dam, by the, where the Juma Cam is. And we saw those little lions attempting to take down that buffalo, which is something that I've never seen before. Let me roll back slightly. Sorry, just so you can see her face again. There it is. So that, Lilani, was probably one of the most amazing and incredible things to see, how little cubs of only a couple of months old have already learnt such important sort of behavior and hunting strategies. Remember that one cub sort of jumped up and put its paws on the rump of that buffalo as it was trying to stand up and make another escape. And then it leapt up on its back. To be so young and to be able to have so much power and muscle tone already that it was able to do that, to me, that was just unbelievable. And I don't know if I'll ever see anything like that soon, especially in a hurry. Or I think it'll probably be a couple of years' time before I'm able to see something like that again. So to me, I think that is probably one of the most special sightings that I've ever had. She's a beautiful girl, though. But let's carry on, though. Let's not get too distracted from our search of Daryl and then Kahuma's. And we're going to actually check another elephant. He's coming out now. This is one of the other bulls that I was telling you about. We'll see him pop out in a moment. Actually, he's going so quickly. You might actually have to wait here and get a glimpse of him. Or you can sort of see him. It's quite difficult. He's far away. He's at that marula now, feeding on a gwari. That doesn't look like Daryl either. That looks even smaller than the two elephants we've just looked at. Okay. We will leave him and we'll continue. We're going to go around and there's a couple more down that way. Come out, come out. Wherever you are, Daryl, I'm going to find you. Now, it may seem that I'm getting too excited about Daryl, but like I said, when you start to spend time with these animals, like we form bonds, of course, with the Nkuhumas and the various leopards, it's quite amazing. And I had a special bond with Daryl. I used to sit outside my windowsill, and it would just be sort of same time, and he'd come walking past, and he'd feed, and then he'd go and drink from the swimming pool. I saw him every single day, if not twice a day. So, and I've told everybody, I bet Louise and Kirsty and everybody is so sick of me talking about Daryl, but I love him. I love him just as much as I love the Nkuhumas, possibly even more though, because I've known him for a little bit longer. He's my long lost friend. And I haven't seen him for 2 months since I've been up here, so I'll be very excited. But let's go check the elephants down this way. Okay, we start to see them in the distance. We're getting there. Now, we drive around quite a bit. I find as though I think I drove a little bit more when I had guests. And I know Crystal was wondering what's sort of the average distance that we drive on a game drive. It's not very much. So they reckon, Brian, how was your conversion to miles? Yeah, it's like mine, hey? Yeah. So I think it's 2.2 kilometers to a mile. No, 1.6. Should we do maths? Let's do maths, because I want to get it right. So, Krista, I'm going to tell you now. So the average game drive is probably about 56 miles. Is that sound right to you? No, I've got to divide it, don't I? Yes. Or do I times it? No, that's too much. No, I did it wrong. I apologize. I'm supposed to divide. So about 20, about 20 miles or so, maybe a bit more than that, to about 25 miles, somewhere around there. It just depends. I'll never forget the one day I did a game drive. I did a loop around the lodge. That's it. For 3.5 hours, I just did a loop around the lodge. Okay, here we've got two more elephants. I need to just get in front quickly. We can see we're going past him, but I'll tell you why now. I want to look at him front on, but just from that little sneaky side view that we just got, I'm not convinced. All right, up we go, the little slip road, and then we'll get the nice light on him as well, which will be quite nice. It is beautiful light so early in the morning. There we go. We're just readjusting, of course, because quarantine is not flat. There's a serious gradient. This is not who we're looking for. But he's another elephant that's very easy to identify by his broken right tusk, his right tusk, and we're looking at him, it's our left, of course. Now, that's quite distinct. Now, perhaps he's done that. Maybe he was boxing with some other elephants and got a bit too rough and snapped his ivory off. But he also looks fairly young. Now, I've been chatting about, and of course I'm sure some of you saw the video about Daryl drinking from the swimming pool. I know Lauren was a little bit concerned, wondering, how do the animals drink from the swimming pools and not get sick? Oh, one elephant was shouting and didn't like something. Now, Lauren, I've seen so many different animals drinking from pools, from giraffe to impala to kudu and bushbuck, even a hyena. Hyena, sorry, I'm just going to say that correctly. And elephants, of course. Lots of different things. Now, we do obviously put chlorine in the pool, but when we're swimming around in the pool, we drink a bit of chlorine too, and I'm sure your dogs at home drink chlorine as well, a little bit of pool water. And I don't think that there's enough chlorine in that water to poison them. The animals are intelligent. Remember, elephants prefer to drink fresh water and will often break open pipes, which we've seen at the Juma Dam before, as well as them digging for fresh water but in the dry riverbeds. So they drink it, and maybe it does their system a bit of good, maybe it flushes it out. But I know that when I'm in the pool, I do drink quite a bit of water, and it never seems to really harm me. The only thing it does is it dries my skin out quite a bit. So they won't drink something if it's not good. And we've seen animals drinking water from pools of water that have been polluted by hippo urine and feces and buffalo urine and feces. And they'll quite happily still drink that. And I think that there's probably a lot more bacteria in pools of water like that rather than a pool that's got crystal clear water and a touch of chlorine to it. So I don't think it's too bad. It's a question that actually comes up quite often. Now, if Daryl was here with these young elephant bulls, they would probably be following him around, and I reckon he'd be like a mentor to these bulls. They're not particularly old, and the fact that they're also hanging around in a group is an indication that they're younger. Generally, the younger bulls do that, and as they get older, they sort of get their independence, like that big bull we saw this morning, and they will sort of live a life of solitary. Now, I haven't seen too many bachelor herds in here, in this sort of area. The biggest bachelor herd I think I saw, which was quite big, was about 20. But up in Zambia, it was very common. You'd see about 50 boys just together all traveling, moving around the plains, which was quite amazing. Now, I'm hearing a lot of chatter on the radio, so I suppose we should maybe have a quick little listen. Let's just check. Aubrey for Taylor. Did you pick up any more tracks?
Negative. Victor and Kunza were four guys. That is the one after I went to the street and go on the chair. I hope not be this. I don't go east to go to the city.
Okay, copy. Thanks very much. Okay. So just quickly checking. It seems as though they haven't had any more luck with the lions. I think what we'll do is let's go check towards the gate very quickly. And then, just to see if we can see where Daryl's footprints went. But that is a busy section, so I'm also wondering if we're going to even see any footprints, but we'll give it a bash. And then we're going to go and drive around where that buffalo carcass is, because there's no more tracks. So maybe they're just lying in some very thick bush, perhaps in the drainage line. It's okay, big boy. But we'll have a quick look at this beautiful Elena again, just as he's happily feeding. And it looks like he's actually on the way to the DRC. He's standing at the entrance now. So they may find a visitor. And because these young elephant bulls are quite curious and they sort of don't have too much fear, I wonder if he's not going to go into the garden and try and eat all the lovely plants that are there, all the succulents and all those delicious things. Louise says that they will be careful and keep an eye out for him. But he will be alright. That's the only thing, though, is when these big gentle giants come through the lodges, they don't mean any harm. They just want to eat all the nice plants that we water and all the time. And obviously they taste delicious, and they don't always find them out in the bush, because often the most delicious plants are always eaten first. But it's when you trap them in sort of a confined area. But remember, they're also big and strong, and if they do feel that they need to race away, a tiny little metal fence is not going to stop an elephant. They will push it over. And they also like to push gates over, which I think you saw as well at Inga's, where Brent and Jamie stay, how they pushed the fence in. Isn't that lovely? Well, we're going to continue the search for either the Nkuhumas or Mr. Daryl. Let's go across to Byron and see how his search for Karula is going.
So everyone, we're back in that area that that we had the tracks, and unfortunately it looks like Karula has possibly just moved south of our boundary. We're on the Gowrie cut line at the moment, and I think it's by the sounds of things, she's moved south, and we saw tracks, and then one of the other vehicles is in this area, and they've gone to check it. They said they can see fresh tracks of this female with the youngsters. So I'm just scanning very, very carefully, because you never know, we might get a glimpse of her, and she may decide to bring the cubs back up in this area. So let's just have a look here for a little bit. Now the car is coming. So I just want to move out the way of the for the other vehicle. So that's how it works sometimes. We have a look at these tracks and try and find and follow these leopards. It's not always easy, but if it was easy, then it wouldn't quite be a wild African experience. And I saw some really nice leopard tracks just off to the side here. I wonder if I can show you where they are. There we go. That's actually, you know what, Dave, we might get a nice view of these tracks over here. Right up against that bank there, I can see two very clear tracks. Let me show you. There we go. All right, let me jump off quickly and show you everyone. Need a stick. There we go. Can you see here? Can you all see that? Very clear. Is it nice, eh, Dave? Yeah. You can see these two very clear leopard tracks in the embankment. Now, to be honest, the ground around here is quite hard already. So these are not fresh tracks. It's one of the signs you can tell if they're fresh or not. But if I can show you on this very clear one over here, you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4 toes of the leopard, and then this is the back pad, so like the palm of our hands, that's the back pad over there. And it's a nice, very round track, so makes it quite easy to identify a leopard track. And this leopard's walked up here, it's come all the way up here, and but like I said, these are not fresh. The ground's quite hard already, so it's not very fresh tracks, but possibly from a day or two ago. I think after we had some of that rain, that may have softened the soil a bit. Just have a look where these other guys have gone, because I do think they may have spotted that leopard just south of a boundary. So let's have a look. It's starting to warm up a little bit now, which is nice. Did he just, I think he's just driven straight down the drainage line. Don't see them, so possibly had this leopard move further down, which is unfortunate, but it's the way it goes. Maybe they get lucky and they see it. Can you see them? Just scan quickly. No, I really don't see anything at the moment. Anyway, let's carry on. Let's have a look around here. We're going to go up the Mulwati, this dry riverbed, and see what we can find. Ah, it's nice and cool down here. Leopold, you have mentioned something interesting, and you say that you've heard that wolf tracks leave a scent behind. Oh, look at this. Yeah. I actually heard this big guy earlier. Come here. There's a beautiful big dung beetle. Look at that, everyone. Oh, look at that massive dung beetle. Oh, you want to take off? How cool is that? And off he went. Large, very large dung beetle. He was catching a ride with us. So Leopold, you say you heard that wolf tracks leave a scent behind. Is it the same with big cats? I don't think we'd be able to smell it, but I am certain that they do leave a scent behind, because if you watch our big cats follow and find each other, they'll sniff around the whole time, and they'll sniff on the tracks where those leopards or lions, whatever big cats, have walked around, and they do follow and then find each other that way. So I do think there is a bit of scent left from the tracks. And I think what happens, though, is it's because probably when they urinate, they'll often scratch their paws through the urine or scrape open the sand and urinate and try and cover it again. Or what they do is they try and reveal very, very fresh soil, and the reason for that is the scent will last longer. But I think with that scratching, they probably get some of that scent on their paws, and while they're walking, they leave the scent. So I think that's what would happen, Leopold. Wouldn't it be wonderful to find a leopard in this drainage line now? And Clay, in Oregon, you said there seem to be a lot of vehicle tracks, and is this a popular tourist spot? Clay, this is a popular tourist destination, but the vehicle tracks that you can see are left by us. This is a private game reserve. It's not open to the public unless you book into the lodges. So you cannot just come and drive around here by yourself in your own vehicle. You have to book into one of the lodges as a guest. And all these vehicle tracks you can see are purely from the game drive vehicles or the safari vehicles, which take the guests out with the guides. That's these tracks that you can see. I'm having a careful look in this drainage line. You never know, maybe the leopards played a prank on the other guys and crossed back into this area. You never know. Love driving through these drainage lines, and always looking for looking for birds, like owls. You get these owls sitting in the dark trees. Last time I was here, which was in June, we had I had a lot of luck finding giant eagle owls in this area. But I haven't heard them since I've been back. So I'm not sure where they are. Or a red-chested cuckoo, everyone. I can hear it. I wonder, let's see if we can find it. Is that not it at the top there? No, that's a dove. Oh, I can hear him, everyone. It's so close. It sounds like it's sitting in the same tree. That's the dove. That's the beautiful Cape turtle dove or ringneck dove. And the cuckoo, which I'm sure you can all hear, sounds like it's calling in that tree, but I can't see it. It's so secretive. Let's go a little bit closer. Leilani, you asked what my favorite bird is to see. I love seeing a martial eagle. It's a very large, beautiful eagle. That's probably my favorite bird, but out here there's so many beautiful birds. I just enjoy birding in general, Leilani. I think it's... Oh, there's another bird calling. Oh, and he sounds like he's right above us somewhere. This cuckoo is here, and I can't see it. You can hear that other bird calling now, everyone. It's called a black cuckoo. So we've got the red-chested cuckoo and the black cuckoo. Now the black cuckoo has got that beautiful call we can hear now. It's going... Listen, everyone. Hear that? Oh, there we go. They describe it as saying, it's going, I'm so sad, I'm so sad. Shame, I feel sorry for the bird. I hope it's not sad, I don't think so. Come on, Dave, we've got to find one of these cuckoos. Aaron in New Zealand, you want to know how good my Hardy Die impression is? Aaron, I will try and do it for you a little bit later. Let's, I don't want to scare off all the wildlife just yet. Okay. He's in this tree and we must find him. Hang on, everyone. Let me see if I whistle if he returns a call. There it goes. Oh, there it goes. There it goes. It just flew off. dark tranquility, you say it's saying I'm so glad as opposed to sad. I think that's perfect. It just flew off. It was sitting right at the back of the tree, but they're incredibly difficult birds to see. These cuckoos are so secretive. And you can hear them. They've all got wonderful calls, and it's easy to identify them by the call, but to see them is not easy at all. But that was the black cuckoo, everyone, that we're looking for. Now, the hardy-dar, Aaron, your hardy-dar call. Oh, dear. Aaron, we're going to head to Taylor for an update, and let me work on my hardy-dar call.
Byron, that's a challenge I'm willing to do. We'll do hardy dark calls. But first, look whose footprints I've got. And I'm going to jump out, so I apologize. I'm going to block the screen quickly. But I want to show you. I'm very excited. Let's just put my cable in my pocket and chase the flies away. Now, let's go this side. And I need a stick, of course. Very important tools while you're in the bush. Now, you can see this massive footprint, which I'm going to stand in now. I fit both my feet in. I am a size 6 US shoe, or 6.5, somewhere around there. It's a big elephant's footprint, but you can't tell. But remember how I've been telling you about these elephants and how you're able to tell the size of an elephant's tusks by the scoring on the tree? Now you can see, you can look at a footprint, that it can be a big footprint. But it looks like it was from last night. There's a couple of little tracks going through. This maybe looks like it could be one of the birds, possibly maybe scavenging just before the sun went down, foraging. And if you look here, that's the toe. So that's the toes that we're seeing over there. That's how I know that it's going that way. That's the direction that we need to go in order to find, of course, this elephant. There's lots of Shongololo tracks, the millipede tracks, in case you don't know what I'm talking about, and a couple of other tracks going all the way around here. But that was the best track that Daryl left. Now I know it was Daryl's track because, well, he was here last night feeding. James said he was right at the gate. We've picked them up. Let's go around and have a look, and let's hope that he's still on Duma somewhere. So I'll try and track them for as long as I can, but it seems as though someone's been driving here. So I think these footprints are going to turn into sort of half tracks. Let's see, or maybe he veered off. No, hang on. Nope, still got them, so I'm just going to focus on the road for the moment. But let me know if you see a big elephant, though. That would also help. Now, they can travel quite a fair distance, though. So he could have moved right out of the area by now, but we'll just have a little scan around here. Don't you see any elephant tracks your side? I don't. Let's just check here. No, I think the tracks go here. Because I don't see anything going that way. So maybe he just turned off the road slightly. Now, speaking about, hang on, so we're actually going to go the other way around. I think he's cut through this block. There was some water back there. But I'm just double checking myself. I think he must have just crossed straight over the road. So Ginny, you were saying, what would we do if that elephant fell into the swimming pool? No ways. Is this him? Is this Daryl? Yes, it's Daryl! Daryl, I'm so excited! Come, Daryl, come to us. Okay, Jenny, let me ask you answer your question very quickly. Yay! I can't tell you, my heart is pounding. It's like going on a date for the first time. That's how I feel right now. So excited. This is Daryl. You can see by the, I call it a bell that he has in his ear. But Jenny, so if Daryl that we're looking at now fell in the swimming pool, because it's a man-made item, we would have to intervene. You'd probably have to drain the swimming pool, because I don't know if he'd be able to get out on the steps. And then you probably have to dart him and sedate him and then get a tractor or a crane or something to try and lift him out, which would be obviously quite difficult. But the elephants know that it's a drop. You often see them sticking their trunks way down and they can feel how deep it is. And they won't just walk into something that's a steep drop unless they somehow were running and they didn't realize that it was there and then they fell over and fell into the pool. But they're more intelligent than that. So same thing with a buffalo would never go in there. A rhino would never go in there. A hyena would never jump in there. They would actually see that it is very deep and possibly there's no entrance or exit. They don't know how to go up steps like we know how to go up steps. So I think that they would avoid it. This is amazing. I'm so happy to see my friend, my long lost friend, Daryl. Hi, Daryl. And hopefully he's going to come a little bit closer so that he comes over and says hello. Well, we don't push him though. I usually let them come towards us. But I wonder if he's going to recognize the sound of my voice. And I'm pretty certain that he used to know me. Every time he'd see me in the beginning, it was always quite awkward. We didn't know each other. He would hesitate. He'd flare his ears at me when I used to try and make the dash to get back into my room. And then it got to the point where he would just sort of smell me and then carry on doing what he did best. Let's go up a bit further, go back a bit. And let's see if we can get a better view. Now, may take some time again. Perhaps he's lost my trust. Maybe he thought that I'd have abandoned him. He probably wouldn't have seen me for some time. And I don't know if anyone else was as fond as Daryl. I think they thought he was a bit of a pain with all the trouble that he caused and all the plants that he ate at the lodge. So the maintenance team and the gardening team didn't enjoy him. Now, we're also right at Gowrie Gate. So you're going to see some fences and some houses where the wardens sort of live around here. And it's quite a nice area to feed. It's actually very typical for elephants to do this, is to come around human sort of habitation and feed on the lush vegetation. And he's big enough that he can reach over the top of the fence and feed on any leaves. But I hope he doesn't do that. Because if he accidentally breaks a branch, well, that could fall on the fence, and we don't want the fence to break. But it's him! I'm so, I'm like a little girl. I'm so excited. Daryl, please come here and say hello. I've missed you so much. Isn't he beautiful? He's a big elephant. You can see the size now compared to those other boys. He'd really dwarf them. I reckon he's coming into about his 40s or so. He's enormous. I don't think he'll get too much larger. Like I said, he's around about 5 tons or so. Now, I know you are all probably wondering and thinking that I'm even more bonkers than what you initially thought. And I know Draw is saying that this is the elephant that comes up to vehicles and is quite naughty and wondering why I like him so much. Now, Draw, I have a completely different relationship with this elephant. I've never seen him be naughty or nasty, and I spent an entire year and a half with him, barring maybe 2 months, so just shy of a year and a half. And he never gave me an ounce of trouble. Even when he was harassing the guests at the lodge, but when I say harassing, I mean, you know, the guests can't go and swim because he's drinking the water from the swimming pool, or no one can get to lunch because he's blocked them in because he's feeding on their pathway type of thing. So, I mean, it's just sort of elephants doing elephant things, eating. And, of course, we as humans have gotten in the way because we built these lodges around them, so we need to let them just carry on with their day. So sometimes we'd have to chase him away, but not ugly. I'd sort of just walk out and show myself to him or whoever was there. And then he'd look at you and he'd ignore you and pretend as though you're not there. And then you'd obviously talk to him, and sometimes what you'd have to do, because if you need to go out on a safari, there's sort of usually only one way to get down to the lodge, and that's on a pathway. And if he's standing at your entrance, well, then you can't really go anywhere. So we would clap our hands, and then they would normally sort of just move off. And then he would. he would go, okay, and cheers. One day, though, I got very cross at him because he'd been around the lodge the entire day and it was hot, so I don't blame him. He was drinking all the water. He had a nap under one of the big marulas in front of the bar on the lawn. And no one could go to the loos. No one could get back to their rooms, which was great. I think it's an amazing experience. It's something, you know, you want to be able to go back home and say, oh, you know, I was late for my safari, or I'm so sorry that I missed your Skype call, but I was trapped at the lodge because there was an elephant on the path. I mean, isn't that just incredible? That's what you want when you come to Africa. And he didn't want to listen and he didn't want to move, and everyone wanted to go back to their rooms after lunch so they can quickly pick up their cameras and their sunscreen and all that type of thing for the safari. We were all running late, so we had to go out to him and he didn't want to move. I clapped my hands at him and he sort of looked at me and he shook his head and he says, nah, the Betty was saying I'm not going anywhere. And I think I've actually told the story before. So I kicked the ground, basically. So I clapped my hands, and it was quite a sandy area, like the road we're on at the moment. And it was a strange noise. So I kicked the sand, and the sand sort of went all over. And then he was like, oh, I don't like that very much. And then he did like a little trot away, and then he looked at me again, and he started eating. And then I said, hey, and then he moved off. Then he went and bothered the people at room number one, which was fine, because at least everybody could get past him and go on the pathway. But he's really never shown me any trouble. I've even seen him when he's been in must. Obviously, you don't view him closely. I probably view him from a distance that we're at the moment. We'd probably be about 50, 60 meters away from him. And he'd never give us any trouble. He'd never want to drive up to an elephant bull in must, though. And he'd just feed quietly. So I don't know. He just always had, he was great. But I just love his tusks. He's just such a big boy. It's got beautiful tusks. Like I said, I like the angle at which they're growing. They're growing quite low down rather than curving, sort of up towards the sky. Well, they're starting to curve slightly. I reckon he's going to be a big tusker, and I hope he lives for many, many, many years. This has made my year. Oh, very nice. So I'm going to stick around with Daryl for a little bit longer. I can't wait, and hopefully he's going to move away from whatever he's feeding on. But let's go across to Byron, who's actually got an entire herd of elephants.
We do have a herd, and I'm happy that Taylor got to find that big male elephant for that big bull, because she spoke about it this morning, so it's amazing. Have a look, everyone, this little one coming close to us. Seems a little bit shy. So, as I was saying, Taylor mentioned this morning that she wants to find that specific elephant. So I'm very, very happy for her that she got to find it. We've just got this little herd, and we often refer to it as a breeding herd, the females with some of the youngsters. The males do like to move on along on their own, as you saw with that bull that Taylor has, or Daryl, as she called him. Don't know if you can call an elephant Daryl, though. I could sit with these elephants for hours, just watching them feeding and just their interaction sometimes with one another. Here comes another one off to our right. Just coming through there. Look at that. Trying to find some wonderful green leaves there off that knob thorn. You can see the knobs on that tree. Can you see that, everybody? That's called a knob thorn. Or an acacia nigrescens, the knob thorn. It's got very sharp thorns, but the elephants don't seem to be mind it. I mean, watch that trunk working. It really is incredible. Here comes another little one that's trying to stick its head through just behind. You can see the little legs. And it might come into frame shortly. Will it? No, it seems to be hiding. It's just behind it. There's the trunk. I always find it fascinating. It takes these little elephant about 2 years to learn how to use their trunks properly. This is also one of my very good friend's favorite animals. I hope she's enjoying it this morning. I know she was watching. Love sitting with the elephants too. And especially baby elephants. Watch, you can see how this young elephant isn't quite as comfortable with feeding on the thorny branches of the acacia tree as the adults are. Chews a little slower. I would say this youngster is possibly about 4 years old, 3 to 4 years old, I would guess. Somewhere around there. So it's still very young, because that elephant next to it is not quite a full-grown adult. So Mystery 154 wants to know, what do elephants like to do after they've eaten? Well, they like to eat some more. They do constantly feed. These elephants, you can imagine, to keep these massive bodies moving, they need a lot of food and a lot of nutrients. And the thing with the elephant is they have a very poor digestive system. They only absorb about 30% of the nutrients from all the food that they eat. So they're constantly feeding. When they're not eating, they're possibly heading towards water and drinking. So the elephants do tend to feed for most of the day. And some of the larger elephants, the big males like Taylor's Daryl that she had over there, he could probably feed on about 250 to 300 kilograms of food a day, which is, what's that, about 500 pounds, 400-500 pounds, I think, of food. That's incredible. Dispatch Griffin, you've noticed the hair on the elephant, and yes, they are very hairy, surprisingly. And you can see, especially around the face and chin, you'll see these little long hairs around there. Let's see if we can, yeah, there we go. It's amazing what we can see with these cameras nowadays and how clear it is. So they are covered in hair, but very fine hair that we can't often see unless you look closely. But around the chin and the face, they do stand out a little bit more, and they've got those beautiful long eyelashes, very long eyelashes. Let's see if we can see that. Yeah, there we go. Just leading that little one off. It it's so peaceful, everyone. The sun is warming the day up. I can hear some cicada bugs calling in the distance. Cape turtle doves calling. There's just a lovely calm that we're experiencing at the moment, even with these elephants moving past us. It's really, really so lovely. I've seen something very interesting that I'd like to show you. Hang on a second. Can you spot anything unusual here? There we go. And that, everybody, is a nest. And that nest is built by frogs. And they have the name, which is very fitting. They are called foam nest frogs because of this beautiful foam nest that they make. And now that the elephants have moved off, let me jump out here quickly. I'd just like to show you and explain a little more. Hold on. The elephants are still over there, you can hear them, but they've moved off a little bit, so I should be all right. Looks like some of them have possibly been bathing here. They've splashed water around this little mud wallow. Actually trying to see if I can't see a little frog hiding on the tree. But everyone, what happens is these foam nest frogs, so they'll sit around the edge of the pan of this water hole, especially after all the rain that we've had, all these little water holes have filled up. So there's probably a lot of frog activity around here. We just can't see them at the moment. Usually they come out at night and they start calling. But what happens is these foam nest frogs will climb up onto these branches, and usually it's the female that climbs up, and she'll go and sit on the branch, and by calling, the males will find the females and vice versa. So the males will then, and I say males because it's not usually just one male. So a number of males will climb up onto the branch, and you notice how that nest has been strategically placed above the water. So what happens is when they're up at the top, the female will start laying her eggs, and the males jostle for the best position to fertilize those eggs. And with all that movement and that liquid, which is quite sticky, it starts to foam up. And that then creates this foam nest around that branch. And what happens is then the eggs are then left within that foam nest. Now, I haven't tasted it myself, but apparently it is distasteful, even though it's bright white and it stands out. I think it is distasteful, so it prevents animals from going and raiding the nest. And also it's in an awkward position. It's not easy to get to those eggs. It takes about a week, about 7 to 10 days, for those little eggs to incubate with inside that nest. And once they hatch, the little tadpoles wriggle and they drop down into the water below them. That's why the nest is above the water hole. So it really is incredible. So within a week, probably this nest will be gone, and those little frogs, those little tadpoles rather, will be in this little mud wallow or water hole, and then eventually they will turn into adult frogs. So it really is fantastic. It's amazing. It's just something that I always find so fascinating in nature. This foam nest frog. Branch just bit me. And yeah, my friend would say, get back in your box, Byron. So I think I'll do that. Wasn't that nice? The elephant, the foam nest frog. It's amazing how much you can see just spending some time in a little area like this. There's a lot going on. Viola, you've asked how many frogs in a nest, and I don't know. Viola, I'm not sure. I wouldn't even hazard a guess, because I've not read anywhere how many little tadpoles hatch out of that nest, or how many eggs are laid. So I don't know. I would guess there's probably quite a few. Probably between 20 and 50, I would assume, somewhere around there, but I'm not entirely sure. Maybe one of our viewers have read up on the foam nest frogs, and I don't know if they've done studies on how many eggs are actually laid. If you have, please let us know. But my guess would be somewhere between 20 and 50, I'm not sure. Okay, everyone, some Inyala. They've probably just come to drink. These are the male Inyala. And you see how important these little water holes are, these little mud wallows that have formed from the rain, or they're filled up rather from the rain. Let's see if this Inyala goes to drink. I'm not sure if he's had a drink already. It looks like he has. You see, he's actually horned the mud, everyone. Now, that is very interesting. You see how his horns are covered in mud. Now, the reason these antelope do that is because when they are fighting and they are displaying, then they thrash their horns through the mud. And the reason for that is then it makes the horns look a bit bigger and darker, so almost like they are a bit more dominant, they're bigger and stronger than the other male. So that's one of the theories behind the reason why these antelope will go and horn the mud, or cake the horns full of mud. And it's not just the Inyala, other antelope do it too. Kudu, the impala do it, quite a few species of antelope do it. And I think it also protects the horns a little bit. That's another theory I've heard. But I think it's mainly it's a dominance display, thrashing the mud. And then with this mud building up on the horn, it makes the horns look a little bit bigger and thicker. All right, we're going to continue our search of fantastic wildlife, and while I do that, Taylor, I think, is still with that elephant, but she's got something else there with it.
You hear me, Louise? Oh, okay, we're just checking. Oh no, watch Daryl now. Daryl, don't do that, because you are not going to be very popular by the people living in that house. Don't you dare push that tree over, Daryl. Hopefully the buffalo will distract him enough that he will not push that over. That's not necessary, Daryl. There's lots of food around you to eat. He's very naughty. He's going to get himself into a lot of trouble if he behaves like that. Isn't this lovely? It's quite a big herd of buffalo coming along here, just funneling past him. And I presume that they're going towards Sydney's dam. Bye, buffalo. They're going to disappear, but isn't that lovely? And I'm sure that they're happy. They seem to not be too bothered having a little look around. And it just shows you, though, how close these animals come right up to where we sort of live. Right up against the fences, it doesn't seem to bother them too much. Quite happy to walk through narrow corridors. Some of them have got a bit startled. I don't know if they've smelt something. We're sitting downwind, so I wonder if there's not maybe something lurking around the dam. Then a couple of them sort of said, nah, we're not going to follow. But we will soon see. And it's always good, as a prey species, to edge on the side of caution and move slowly and stop regularly and listen. and really just take it easy, because I think when you're in a hurry, that is where the predators then have the advantage, because they're not listening properly, they're not looking, they're probably not smelling as well as they normally would. And then, of course, well, the predators can just jump out and surprise them. Now, I'm actually changing my mind. I wonder if the little buffalo herd that's up ahead of us hasn't perhaps seen some people walking around. Like I said, we're here near a warden's house, and there's probably a bit of maintenance going on. Maybe there's even a workshop up there. But we can sort of just see those there, a little bit not as comfortable as the rest, that have quite happily walked straight towards Sydney's dam. If you can hear dogs, it's probably the anti-poaching dogs. So we have dogs that are able to sniff for various things, so for endangered species as well as for weapons and ammunition. And we've got a big gate, and as everybody comes through the gate, they search your vehicle and make sure you're not trying to bring anything you're not supposed to or take anything out. So those are those dogs barking in the background. And you can see now Daryl as well is... Daryl, I think you need to come away from there, my friend. Why don't you come over to us and say hello? I worry about Daryl. Like I say, I don't think anyone is really as tolerant as what I am sort of towards him. I take all of his nonsense because I have such a good bond with him. It's very peaceful today, Archie. A slight gentle breeze, as all, which I'm sure he's enjoying. Sorry, I just heard a buffalo making a noise, but perhaps it was just a little squabble between the ones that were heading down to the dam. Now, speaking about elephants, and I said to you that I reckon Daryl's probably coming into his 40s, or maybe he's already there. And Madison was wondering, how long do elephants normally live for? They actually live for quite some time. They can live but anywhere between 60 and 70 years, but it's not that they die of old age. It's actually got to do with their teeth. Sorry, I'm closing my eyes now because I'm staring into the sun. I'll try and open them occasionally. So basically, I've got six sets of molars that come through and push forward like a conveyor belt. And, well, every 10 years or so, they seem to get a new set of teeth. So that's how they've sort of aged out. Depending on what they eat, if it's very sort of hard and dry vegetation, so you can imagine during the droughts when the vegetation is not great and green and luscious, their teeth wear down a lot quicker. But now that we've got a bit of greenery, it should be all right, and they could live for a little bit longer. And I reckon if an elephant had another set of teeth, they'd probably live close to about 100. Isn't that amazing? Let's see what Daryl's up to now. He's coming out. Now, he keeps going to this tree, and he keeps wanting to push, looks like a knobthorn over. Now, I'm happy if he pushes it over this way. That's fine. Let's see. Yes, he's going to it again. But before, he was pushing it over towards the house. I don't want him to push it onto the house, of course. Like I said, he will not be very popular then up here in the north. And you already have a reputation, mister. I think you need to clean your name up a little bit. Let's see, he's very interested by it. He doesn't need to push it over. And if he does, I don't think he'll uproot that tree. It'll probably just sort of snap quite close to the base. But then I suppose he'll eat the leaves. And the leaves from the knobthorn are lovely. Quite delicious. Now he's just feeding on something else. Speaking about elephant teeth, I know, Kim, you were wondering, do the elephant teeth come through at once, or do they only come through when needed? So they've got bottom teeth on either side of the jaw, as well as top molars on either side of the jaw. They like molars. And what happens is that they start at the back, so where our wisdom teeth come through, they push up through there. And the teeth move forward towards the front of the jaw like a conveyor belt. So sort of like when you have sushi and your sushi comes around on a conveyor belt, exactly like that, except they don't go round and round. So the teeth that are closest to the front of his mouth, so sort of to where the tip of his tongue is, those teeth will often wear down and you'll see them, they'll look very sort of flat. There's not a lot of grooves and things in them. Whereas at the teeth at the back, the new teeth that are coming forward and pushing through have all these lovely deep grooves. And that's something maybe one day we'll find an elephant skull and can perhaps have a look at their teeth. So it's sort of like, I suppose it's almost, the set comes through slowly. I mean, the teeth don't just all fall out at once. It's quite a process. Look how he's stretching up now, though. Look at he's doing serious yoga this morning. Maybe we'll have to go forward a little bit. Let's reposition so we can get a clear shot of Mr. Darrell stretching up and feeding on the trees. This is quite nice. You really see how giant, enormous he is. But he's feeding against the fence. Now, Darrell, please don't pull any branches down onto that. Yes, just pull little bits off. There we go. Sorry, I've parked at a slight angle again. Well, we shall fix it. And there he is. And he is lovely and happy and just feeding on his favorite plants. Isn't that fantastic? Right, Darrell, your time is almost over to be a superstar. And I think let's go across and see how Byron is doing.
So from the largest land mammal here to one of the smallest, there's little dwarf mongoose, everyone. Look at that, isn't that cute? Look at the little nose twitching. There are a few of them around, but they are quite shy. I'm hoping if we are patient, some more might come out. Oh, I see movement, but that's a beautiful view of that one. Just the bottom left-hand side of that termite mound, you'll see another one. There we go. Now, these dwarf mongoose are very gregarious, which means they live in large family groups. So there are quite a few spread out around here, but they're probably hiding from us at the moment. They are shy little creatures, and these little dwarf mongoose will feed on insects that they find. I've seen them hunting grasshoppers before, where they run and jump and pick them off the grass. All right, just move. There goes the other one. And they do live in abandoned termite mounds. They'll make their homes in there. And there it goes. It's hiding from us now. But wonderful sighting. Lovely to see it. The two dwarf mongoose. I did see movement of one or two others around. But they, as I said, they are a little shy and they move off at times. But they can get a bit curious if you're lucky. They may come and have a look and peer around the termite mound and see what you're doing. I can see one or two still moving around there. But what a lovely sighting. Nice to see the dwarf mongoose. Dark tranquility. You say the dwarf mongoose remind you a little bit of small birds. That's interesting. I don't know. Maybe because of the call. They've got this high-pitched little squeal that they give off. Maybe the movement and the beady eyes, perhaps, are still of birds. I don't know. Maybe. And speaking of bird calls, I know Aaron was asking about my hardy dog call. But before I do my hardy dog call, Wilma wants to know, do these dwarf mongoose or mongoose species eat snakes. They do, some of them. Not so much the dwarf mongoose. I think they're quite small. And you asked, is it only venomous snakes? No, they'll eat any snake, I think. And usually it's the larger mongoose species. And yeah, especially slender mongoose and that, they'll go for snakes, I know, and probably yellow mongoose. Those are usually solitary, they're not in big groups. These bigger groups often mob the snakes and chase them away. But a dwarf mongoose, I mean, I think they do feed on some reptiles, but I've never seen them feeding on a snake. Maybe the larger ones, like the banded mongoose, perhaps, and it'll be any snake, not just the venomous ones like the cobras and that we get in this area. It'll be any snake. Yes, Ellie, you wanted to know if the dwarf indicates that they are a smaller species. They are the smallest mongoose species, hence the name the dwarf mongoose, because they are so small. So it does indeed indicate the size. So now, and to show you, if I had to show you quickly the size of a dwarf mongoose, if it was sitting in front of me, with the tail, it's probably only about that long. But the body, I would say, is about that big. That's how big the dwarf mongoose is. Very small, very, very small. I don't know about that. So just to give you an idea of how big they are. Anyway, Aaron, you've been patiently waiting for the hardy dog call. I don't know. But they've got a very harsh, loud sound, and it varies slightly, but it's a... No, I'm gonna have to try that one again. That was terrible. That was Aaron, I'm sorry, that was not a hardy dog call. Whatever. Let me play a hardy dog call for you quickly. Because oh dear. Okay, listen to this quickly. That was kinda close. You hear that very, very harsh, very, very harsh call. So, not quite what I did, but it was close. Okay, so there was no sign of Karula and her cubs. I think she headed south across our boundary. But, you know, as we've seen the last few days, she could appear at any time again. I think what we are heading into the area where James had shadow yesterday. I'm just curious, she had a very small kill, and I don't think she would have hung around too much. She probably would have finished that. But it's worth just having a look. She could still be in the area. So that's where we're heading now. Betty Sleep would like to know if I can do a James Hendry impression. Oh dear. James Hendry impression. Alright. well, James. Yeah, James has got this slight British accent, which I don't know where it comes from, because he's from Johannesburg, so I'm not sure. But James seems to talk with authority, and he's got a wonderful, wonderful vocabulary which he uses frequently. And maybe that's not the best James Hendry impression, but he'll always go, "Thank you very much," when he does something great and people applaud him. He is a wonderful guitarist, though. He's an incredible guitarist and musician. I am envious. It's one of his many charms, his guitar and his singing. He is a very, very talented singer. We used to, maybe letting out some secrets here, but we used to get quite jealous of James because he would arrive in the Boma in the evening while we're sitting around with guests and other staff members, and there'd usually be, well, not usually, occasionally there'd be perhaps a ranger trying to impress a young lady, one of the staff members, new staff members that arrived, and, you know, and try and impress her with these stories of tracking lions and tracking leopards and finding elephant. And James would then arrive and start playing his guitar and singing, and you could see the ranger's chances vanishing very quickly before his eyes, because it's hard to compete with a guitar around the fire. brings back some good memories. Yes, Margaret, I have neck and back issues regularly because of turning and driving vehicles. And I do think that, we try and exercise almost daily, especially out here, which is great. There's a few of us that exercise. We go running. So Steph, James, Dave, myself, Connor, we'll all try and exercise. And it's good for your core, and that helps because you're turning and talking all the time. So it is good, and you do need to do it, because I have found that over the years of driving and turning regularly like this, my lower back does get a bit sore at times. So every now and then, make an appointment with the chiropractor, straightens me out, checks my wheel alignment, as I always say, and then. And then I'm usually fine again for a while. Okay, so we're going to carry on searching for the position where Shadow was in yesterday. While I do that, let's head back to Shadow. Let's head back to Taylor, and maybe she is casting a shadow.
The vehicle's, yes, casting a big shadow. Now, we've still got Daryl. Thank goodness he's moved away from that fence and pushing the trees over down on the fence. Now, I have an update for you. I've just heard that the Nkuhuma Pride are actually in Arethusa, and it seems as though they've taken down two buffalo, from what it sounds like. And I inquired, and I got a standby number 17. Can you believe that? Standby number 17. And I don't think we're going to have enough time in this drive to see them. If it was standby number 3 or 4, then yes, perhaps in 40 minutes or so, that would have been perfect. But what we'll do is we'll head there early in the morning, in the afternoon, and we'll sort of try and beat the rush to them and then have a look. So we'll have to give the Nkuhumas a skip this morning just because of time restraints. But at least we found one of the things we were looking for. And I'm going to move forward a little bit. But we're going to have one last look at Daryl. And then we are going to carry on and see what else we can find. But it makes me very happy that he has indeed moved away. Thank goodness, Daryl. We'll have a quick look over here. And possibly we'll even see him at the DRC, because it seems as though he's on his way and heading in that direction. But I am absolutely ecstatic that I have been reunited with my long-lost friend, who's probably going to hang around for a couple of days, hopefully a few weeks, and even better if he hangs around for a few months. But I did try and talk to him and call him. I called out Daryl for about 10 minutes straight, and he didn't really respond to me, which I'm a little bit heartbroken about. But perhaps he's giving me the silent treatment, because I just disappeared. And I didn't tell him where I was going. I didn't leave him a note. Sorry, Daryl. I apologize. I didn't mean to if I've hurt your feelings. I'm very sorry. Now, speaking about Daryl's unique marking, that sort of bell shape of a Pac-Man ghost or a Snapchat sign, I know that once upon a time, was wondering what caused it. Now, I reckon he's got another little hole in his ear, if you look here as well, on his right ear, is that when he was younger, perhaps he walked through a dense thicket with lots of thorns, and maybe a thorn made a little hole in his ear. And then often what happens is it's the bacteria that eats away at a wound like that in the ear, and it creates these amazing shapes. So I think that is what happened. Maybe he even got a tusk through the ear. I'm not sure, because it's quite a big one. I've seen elephants with perfect circles before and a variety of different shapes. And then off he goes. It is. I think he's actually heading towards the DRC. Let's go a little bit further forward. I don't want to get stuck with him on the road because he's a rather large elephant, so I wouldn't mind trying to actually get past him. But now you can really see how enormous he is. Right, but we're going to say goodbye to Daryl now, so everybody send your regards and hopefully we'll see him this afternoon, but I believe Byron's got kudus alarming.
Everyone, we're in this area that Shadow was around yesterday, but I just myself and David just heard kudu alarm calling. Let me just stop and listen again. Let's try and work out where they are. I hope they haven't stopped. Come on, one more alarm call. There we go, straight ahead. Okay, there was a loud bark. It's a very loud bark. It's a bow, bow. That's the sound that the kudu make, and that's their alarm call. So let's have a look, everybody. Let's scan very, very carefully around here. This is really exciting. It's quite thick through here at the moment. Just going to listen again here. And usually what happens is the alarm calls chase away the predator because it draws attention to them, and they don't like that. Let's maybe just go a little bit further down. I don't see any kudu just yet. Come on, there's got to be something here, everyone. There the kudu are over there. Okay, I'm going to drive in here. Let's have a look. I see the kudu. Oh, it's not easy. It's not easy to try and drive and spot. There's an impala. Okay, there's an impala over there, off to our left. Yeah, the kudu are. Okay, they're all looking in this direction. So, can you see them? They're just off to our right here. Let's just listen. I'm just going to scan very carefully. There's an impala right here. Okay, I hear some more impala alarm calls coming from ahead. But we need to look very, very carefully here, everyone. Just trying to see if there's no tracks around. I don't see anything. Mary, you asked, could it be wild dogs? And I don't think so, and I'll tell you why. It's because Hang on, here's the Impala, but they don't seem as phased. You know what, they're also looking behind us. Those kudu are all looking to the other side, so let's head back there quickly. Mary, you asked if could they be wild dog, and I'd highly doubt it, because Impala and that are still standing around and they're alarm calling, and I've noticed that there's very different behavior from these antelope when they're wild dog around. And the Impala don't necessarily stand an alarm call. What they will do is they will most likely alarm call once, if anything, and then just run, because wild dog are persistent hunters. They run down their prey, they don't stalk. So for them to stand an alarm call is pointless, because the wild dog will run and hunt them. So all they do is they run off, and that's usually what happens. So for these kudu to also stand an alarm call, there's some buffalo through here. Wow, everyone, it is thick and it's not easy. Now, you just have to think, if you were a leopard, where would you go? Because I do think it's possibly a leopard that was through here. Chata, be good. Still some Impala dotted around. Oh. It's so difficult at times, you can imagine. And what happens is that once these predators get seen, they do try and move out of the area very quickly. I'm just going to listen quickly. I see some Impala up ahead. So there's a lot of antelope around here to warn us. But as I was saying, once they start being alarm called at, they lose that element of surprise. And generally, the predators will then move out of the area. They'll try and sneak into a thicket and get away. Don't hear anything else. Let's just quickly have a look down here towards this, like a little bit of a drainage line. Can be quite frustrating at times. You know something is around, but just to find it is so difficult. I definitely think they saw something. I mean, the Impala were alarm calling, but the Impala did seem a lot more relaxed than the kudu. I think the kudu probably saw whatever it was, and they were alarm calling and alerted the Impala, and the Impala then began to alarm call too. Nothing this side. Let's head back to towards those kudu, where we saw those kudu, and let's just have a look around there. Bit tricky moving through these areas, all these pushed over branches and trees. Gold, you asked why don't we use electric vehicles. Al Gold, I used to work at a lodge that pioneered the research into electric vehicles and trying to get them to work, and we approached Land Rover and we tried to come up with an electric vehicle. It It's not that easy. It's not that easy just to come up with an electric vehicle. You can imagine, you need to power them. You need the power to also drive through very tough terrain. Some of them do have the torque, but it's not as easy as it sounds. And to also carry around all the batteries that you need to get these vehicles going, they're very, very heavy. So it's tricky to have electric vehicles, but there is studies and research and planning and experimenting and all going into trying to get electric vehicles. A question from Fuzzman Sparkles, and you wanted to know, is it possible that the kudu may have been alarm calling at a rock python or a snake? Possibly. It is a possibility. But I think the impala then would have come into the area and probably alarm called a bit more. If it was something like that. Okay, everyone. Sorry, it doesn't seem like we've been able to find anything, but I'm not going to give up just yet. I'm going to look around this area very, very carefully and see if we don't come up with anything. While I do that, let's head back to Taylor, see if she's left her elephant.
I have indeed left Daryl. I handed him over to Ephraim because I don't know if his guests had quite seen such a beautiful big elephant like Daryl. Now, I know that Byron did a hardy dar call earlier, and I've been practicing mine, so I think we should probably do one. And now, Brian and I have decided we're going to do a group call, so we're doing a flock of hardy dars, not just an individual, because that's normally how we hear them. Are you ready, Brian?
I'm always ready.
1, 2, 3. Ha, ha, ha! 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 That's our hardy dar impression, and we didn't seem to scare the zebra, so we must have been quite convincing, because normally when I do any of my other calls, the animals all run in the opposite direction. So that was the hardy dar call, and it was something that we were also practicing, is we were trying to practice a woodland kingfisher call, but we've worked out that this is quite a difficult one to do. We may have to team up and sort of break the call into two parts to try and get the whistle, and then of course that sort of very fluty, I don't even know what you'd call the other part of the call, it's going to be difficult. So that is a thing that we're working on, and when we feel as though we've got it down, we shall do it for you. So perhaps in the next couple of days, maybe in the next week or so, just to give us a bit more time to practice. Well, that's a zebra using the luxury bathroom, of course. Now, I wonder how long it's going to take for the dung beetles to arrive. Maybe this will be an interesting experiment. Maybe we should sit and see and time how long it takes the dung beetles to arrive. Okay, so it's 7:29 here in South Africa. And let's do a bit of an experiment, and I'll tell you why. It's because I've been told that it takes exactly 20 minutes for the dung beetles to find that fresh dung. Now, I've actually seen a dung beetle already. Let me go forward slightly so we can get a better view of the dung. So we're 7:29. I like doing experiments. Oh my goodness, it's going to be quicker. Let's see, I'm just trying to find a clear little gap here. Hi, zebra. I'm going to change my position slightly. Okay, there's a dung beetle flying around. Sorry, I've parked up on a slope, but it's the best view. And let's see, there's a big dung beetle. Like I said, he's surveying the area. Is it going to find the dung? Well, the flies are already there. And I'm checking the time as we're looking here. Anyone seen any dung beetles come through yet? There it is. Oh, my goodness. And the first contender has arrived, but he's stuck upside down. It took him a whole of 1 minute to find that dung. Now, I can put that myth of 20 minutes to rest and say that if there are any dung beetles in the area, it's almost instantaneous that they will pick up that fresh dung. And that's because of the antennae that they have on their head, those little small ones. They're quite feathered. And those are sense receptors. Isn't that amazing? Here's another one. Oh, my goodness. So within 2 minutes, we've got two dung beetles. Go, dung beetles. Now we're going to watch them dig and try and separate that fresh dung. We're going to see how quickly they get you. That was actually amazing, and that worked so much better than I thought it was going to. Let's see, they seem to be struggling to actually pull it apart, though. Have you noticed that? Are you not satisfied with the feces of a zebra? Goodbye. Okay, well, that's a bit rude. Well, we've still got our one friend here. Come on, you can pull it apart. There we go. No. This is actually quite interesting. Here's another one that's joined as well. Maybe it's still too hot. I don't know. I don't know why they aren't pulling it apart. Oh, that one's also left now. Now, we have a question from Louise in Final Control. And she was wondering if it's more difficult to pull apart when it's fresh. Now, I don't think so. Because as this feces bakes in the sun, it gets a hard crust on the outside, which then makes it difficult. They sort of have to crack into the little nugget, I don't know what you'd call a piece of dung, and then try and pull out the softer bits on the inside. Maybe it's a bit slippery, I'm not sure, but they do seem to be struggling a little bit. But you can see where the flies are all sitting in the middle, but you can see that that's perfectly open, so I'm wondering why they aren't going there, because that would be very easy to pull apart. And they've got, if you've ever picked up a dung beetle, actually any beetle, I'm sure you would have felt all those sort of hard bristles on their legs, or like little grooves. Maybe they're being quite cheeky and they're just trying to take one of those little nuggets of zebra feces. So there we go. They're all coming around, and maybe try and roll that away, which is cheating, of course. You can see, look, they're able to get inside. That one's just pulled this dung bit apart. Dung nugget apart, sorry. There we go. Finally, someone has found the one in the middle. They're not impressed by this, though. And I've never known dung beetles to have a preference to dung. I mean, I've seen them collecting impala dung before and rolling it up and taking it away. You see how easy it is to open up? It's not difficult. I've seen them with buffalo dung, zebra dung, all the different types of dung. I've seen dung beetles sort of coming towards and having a look at it. Let's see if we can get anything to come through and successfully roll a ball. Now, speaking about bugs, and as we watch them, I know Maggie from Ohio was wondering if I've ever swallowed a bug while driving. Maggie, I've swallowed many bugs that would probably fill up a large dinner plate. I've eaten flies, actually a couple while I've been live here, and almost felt the need to get sick. I've eaten a butterfly once, which I don't think is very good. It was a little butterfly, of course, because I've heard that sometimes, well, there was a case in South Africa quite a few years ago, almost maybe 10 years ago, I remember I was on camp when we heard about this, and a butterfly flew into a boy's mouth. And unfortunately, he ended up dying. And they said it was because of the sort of powder, the dust that you see on their wings. Maybe he had an allergic reaction and it closed his throat up, which I thought was quite scary for her. Then I used to run around with my mouth closed. But I didn't die. I was okay. What else? I've had dung beetles hit me in the face before and all sorts of other things. So, yeah, we've had lots of different things. I've eaten termites on purpose and then also not on purpose. So quite a few things. I wouldn't like to eat a dung beetle, though. They seem busy. These two seem to be semi-satisfied with the dung. No, that one's not. As I said, that he flew away. But there's a couple of smaller dung beetles that have now joined to the right of the flies. You see the long legs. I wonder if that wasn't a spider dung beetle because it had particularly long legs. Lots of different insects coming through now. Of course, the flies are coming to feed on the moisture that they're getting off of the dung. And of course, the dung beetles actually want the feces. So they also feed on the dung themselves. But the main thing is to house a sort of home and a food source for the egg and then potentially for the larvae if the egg successfully hatches. See, digging in all the different nuggets. Now, it seems as though we're talking about dung. Soraya from New Jersey, you were wondering, if the dung beetles didn't eat the dung, would the bush be overrun with the feces? That's correct. You are 100% right. Ooh, let's see, they seem to be having an argument now. And I love the way that they're able to flick each other around. Maybe these dung beetles are actually just eating themselves because we haven't seen them try and make a ball. We've seen them open it up a little bit and actually pop some of it in its mouth. So I wonder if they just aren't having a feed now this morning as well. And sorry, Soraya. So yes, that's definitely it. Between the dung beetles and the termite mound, the termites and the maggots, they're responsible for getting rid of all this sort of organic matter. And of course, the dung beetles and the termites do a very, very good job. Sorry, that is me. I'm going to very quickly take my foot off the brake. I was very silly and I forgot it on here. I apologize. There we go. Very, very sneaky of me. My foot stuck to the pedal. And so yes, you saw how very early this morning, perhaps if you did catch the beginning of the show, we saw a couple of dung piles that had almost sort of looked like the feces was all loose and it was spread out quite a bit on the ground. And that's what they do. They start to eat it from underneath. You get all the different types of dung beetles. So the endocorporate dung beetles, which live inside the dung, so they don't roll balls. They're often responsible for, it almost looks like they thin the dung out and it becomes light and fluffy and they try and take out all those nutrients. So they like to do that. And eventually it will just go away with the combination of the rain and the wind. It'll just disappear and turn into nothing. Now there's lots of tiny little beetles you can see moving around. And I think that's what this dung beetle is doing, as I think it was actually eating itself, eating the dung instead of just trying to roll a ball up. That's quite interesting. You see there, they dig, open it up and then move off onto the next one. Ah, look at the sneaky one on the left, doing exactly what I said it was trying to do. Well, the one on the left did a big, really did flip there. And the other smaller dung beetle. Now, David from Napa, you were wondering, how do the dung beetles find the dung so fast? And that's because of the little antennae that you see over there. They are feathered, like almost feathered like a moth's antennae. And they are very good sense receptors. So they're able to pick up sort of by smell. Goodbye. And they'll figure that out. But there's so much feces around in the bush. There's so many different animals, of course. But wasn't that absolutely wonderful? So I think we saw a combination of things. I think we saw the dung beetles eating. That one very quickly, I don't know if you saw, found a small enough sort of nugget of zebra dung and tried to actually almost roll it away and then worked out well, if it's an oval, it doesn't roll very well. And they keep going on. But wasn't that wonderful? I think we're going to move on now from the dung beetles. Good luck, dung beetles. I hope you find what you're looking for today. Well, let's jump onto the back of Byron's vehicle and David and see if they're burning up in the sun like I am.
We are starting to warm up quite a bit, but anyway, no luck unfortunately with those alarm calls that we heard. We found the kudu and the impala, but not what they were alarm calling at. We had a good look around that area. I drove in and out of there. There's a lot of antelope around, and they definitely would have alarm called again if whatever it was that they saw had stayed in the area. I think perhaps there was quite a thick little drainage line moving north from there, and I think perhaps whatever it was may have slipped in there. I have a feeling it was a leopard, but I don't know for sure. But judging by the alarm calls and that, I just have a feeling it was a leopard. So, anyway. Dispatch Griffin, you wanted to know, you're saying you're enjoying rooibos tea? Why would you do that to yourself? No, I'm joking. Some people like it, some people don't. I'm not a huge fan of rooibos. Dave, do you like rooibos? Love rooibos, okay. So, but you asked if it grows in this area. No, it doesn't. And the proper rooibos tea is grown. It's not, you don't really find it out. Just out in the bush, from what I know, but we have got something that we make bush tea out of, and it is called the. It's a Combretum tree. It's a russet bush willow. Now they don't have a lot of seed pods at the moment, but what you can do is you get a whole bunch of these seed pods, and they're very very small. They're reddish brown in coloration. Sorry, Lou's just updating me with what I'm telling you. She picked up the wrong radio, I think. Just wanted to show you there's an elephant, everyone. Look at that. Just a lone bull. So speaking about the russet bush willow. And then Paula walking into the frame. Oh wow, just having a look around. There's the impala, the elephant, and I don't know if you'll see it, but back right there's a giraffe. Straight through, it's actually hiding behind some tree. There we go. Look at that. See that? There's a giraffe hiding over there. Nice to see different species all in the same area. This elephant seems to be coming closer to us, which will be nice. So getting back to the bush tea that we make. And this, you get this russet bush willow, these pods, bush willow pods. And you take a bunch of them. They're reddish brown in color, and you can drop them in hot water and stir it up a bit, and you get like a bush tea. I have tried it. I think I tried it with James actually a few years ago. It was terrible. It wasn't very tasty at all. Didn't taste like tea, but it did flavor the water, and perhaps we didn't brew it correctly. Wow, this elephant's only got one tusk, everyone. Do you see that? Now, it is not unusual to come across an elephant with one tusk. And I was going to say, because the other one may have been broken off, and that's exactly what's happened here. This male has broken off his right tusk. You can see the remaining part of the tusk over there. Now, I'm sure most of you would be wondering, will that grow back? No, it won't. There are nerves that run through the tusk, and it can be painful if they do break them. But once those nerves have been severed, it's not able to grow again. And this elephant is just dropping some more food for the dung beetles. Oh, Stephanie, you've asked if the elephant, or because the elephant digestive system is so poor, would they be considered to be more prehistoric? Now, that's an interesting question. I would guess so. If you think of the woolly mammoth that was prehistoric and compare that to the elephant, they were so similar. So maybe the elephant's digestive system hasn't evolved as much as some of the other animals. It's an interesting question. I'm not sure, but it sounds plausible. Very good question. Right, I think why don't we head up towards quarantine area, those clearings, to see what we have around there. I see there's a vulture in a tree in the distance, and that's possibly because of that lion kill, that buffalo kill that was there yesterday. Jennifer, so Steph has shown you that elephant dung tea, I believe, where he squeezes the moisture out of the elephant dung. And you want to know if I've ever tried it? No, fortunately, I've never needed to. If I was stranded in the bush and I had no other option, I would do it because that's survival. But luckily, I carry a water bottle with me. So what happened to my water bottle? Oh, dear. No, it's all right. Well, we got a big water bottle, so so we're all right. We won't need to drink any elephant dung tea. While I head towards the clearings, Taylor's got some birds on the ground.
Now, that is not the crowned lapwing making that noise. It is Brian and I trying to communicate with the birds this morning, and we were actually successful. We at one point were making that noise, we were a bit closer to the vehicle, and there was one that was sort of responding though, but I don't know what it was saying. It was probably telling us to go away or "you sound terrible." Probably one of those two. And there's about five of them running around here, so I'm not sure if they're just out on a foraging mission because they seem to be covering quite a fair sort of distance. And you can see that one has obviously found something delicious. Now, they eat a variety of different things. You often see them eating little insects, but I'm sure that they peck away at a couple of seeds too. And we wondered if they did have a nest around here. Maybe they do. Their nests are very well hidden on the ground. It's almost a little indentation on the ground, and then they just lay their eggs there. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, the eggs are normally a brownish color. Let's have a quick look on this app. Yes, they are. I couldn't remember. Oh no, let me just show you. I couldn't remember between them and the spotted thickney. Let's have a look. No, I want that one, not a black winged. Where is the one I'm looking for? Sorry, I'm trying to find it now. My phone seems to have frozen there. Let me scroll. I'm going to have to tilt my phone. Let's look at the eggs. So let's do this. That's better. Can you see that? Don't look at the size though, it's wrong. And beautiful brown eggs to blend into the ground. And they'll almost be invisible, and it's quite easy to stand on them, so it's always good when you are walking in the bush just to be careful. Not to always have to watch out for things like snakes and scorpions and insects and those type of things, but it's very important that you look for birds' nests, and it's very, very, very easy to squash them. I remember growing up, we lived on it's called a small holding, so it's not quite a farm. It was just a couple of hectares of land, and my dad just had cuckoo grass growing everywhere, so it was just like a big golf course, really. It was quite ridiculous, and of course we had to mow this lawn. And we had a big lawn mower that we used to sit on, and we always used to have, it was sort of my brother and our chores, once a week on the weekend. It would take us 3 hours to mow the lawn, and we would do this. And before though, because I was very paranoid and I very much loved animals, and we had spotted thickneys and all crowned lapwings and all sorts of ground-dwelling birds running around. And I'd go and I used to walk up and down the property looking for nests, and I found a couple of nests. And then I'd have to go and find big rocks and put it around, not on top of the nest, but around there, because my dad, he would just mow. He just went, and whatever was in the way, he used to just mow over. So I put big rocks everywhere. And
And he used to get quite upset because then he'd have to come with a weed eater, you know, one of those little whippersnappers, and then cut the grass around the rocks because he couldn't mow it properly. But that's the end of my crowned lapwing story. Hope you enjoyed it. But let's go back across to Byron, who's got a water buck.
I have indeed got a water buck and a warthog. Look at the little warthogs in the back. Now they have found such a beautiful area. I cannot tell you how noticeable the change has been over the last 2 weeks with all this green grass that has shot up after the rain that we've had. We are so fortunate in this area, everybody. The southern part of the Sabi Sands is still very, very dry. And look how these antelope and warthog are enjoying all these green grass shoots. Have a look at that warthog back right. You can see it on its knees feeding, and that just allows it to get down and it can move around and feed on the grass, and the grass shoots very, very easily. Look at that. You've got such character. I love warthog, I really do. They're in the shade there too. That waterbuck moved off. It looks like he's moved off just behind the termite mound, but there's that other warthog still there. Just enjoying the cool breeze, the green grass, the shade. Life could not be better at the moment for those warthog. I suppose actually if they were in a mud wallow, they love wallowing in mud, and that could possibly be better than this. So if there was a mud wallow around there, it would be like a holiday. And it's nice and open so they can keep an eye out for any potential predators if there was something around. So they're completely safe out there. They're incredibly fast. Very, very fast and agile. So unless a predator really ambushes them, the chances of them catching the warthog are not very, very good. What a beautiful scene. There's large trees, marula trees around them. And the warthog's enjoying the shade and the green grass. Flies bothering us at the moment. All right, let's continue and see what else we find. Taylor's got another warthog, but it sounds like it's right next to her. Let's have a look.
As we were coming around the corner, we found this little piggy having a snooze. As you can see, it looks like a male warthog, a little bit tattered though. You can see ears are a little bit torn, covered in mud though as well, so probably yesterday or the day before it had a mud bath. And it's quite strange, it doesn't want to move, and I'm quite happy with just sitting here watching this warthog. But it seems absolutely exhausted. Oh, it's reacting, there's a roller flying around it, and it got that sort of jump that it did, it got a bit of a fright. It's okay, you can carry on sleeping. Now, this little one is probably going to have to get up and move at some point. I say little, it's not really little. Just because the sun is going to move around and that shade is already starting to disappear. You can even see, as since we've been here, a lot more light coming through now. So, Piggy, I think you're going to have to go and find a wallow under some shade. And I know a good spot, so if you can understand me, if you head to Chelepan, there's a lovely tree and a nice pond of water with lots of mud, and I think that you could probably rest there for most of the day. You'll probably be bothered by some elephants though, but they'll move off eventually. Are you thinking about it? Are you perhaps going to go there? Maybe not. But a lovely warthog nonetheless. Life must be tough
when you're constantly on the menu for other animals. So something like a warthog just sitting out here in the open, not much cover other than it being in the shade. It's actually quite vulnerable. Now you better be careful and keep an eye out. But you can see listening though, in the distance, as the birds fly over, it does react now, it's looking around. And they've got a very good sense of smell. You can see that little snout is nice and dirty. It was obviously out grazing. And typically the top of their snout is always covered in mud or sand. And that's because it's very, very hard. So there's quite hard cartilage there. And they use that like a spade to dig up the grass. Isn't that beautiful? Very hairy warthog too. Right, little warthog, we're going to leave you now, but enjoy your day and enjoy the shade. And I hope that nothing eats you. Good luck. May nature be kind to you. Unfortunately, we're reaching the last couple of minutes of the show, and it's been wonderful as always. So from myself, Brian, and the Thumb, of course, we'll catch you this afternoon for the sunset safari. But I believe that Byron has got some elephants.
We've got two big elephant. Look at that. This is a really large bull in front of us. And they're enjoying the shade, and I thought it was a good idea to come and join them. So we in the cool shade with this breeze blowing. Really is lovely. And look how this elephant is actually resting. He's got his trunk on the ground. Look at that, everyone. And they do this at times. They kind of... almost like they doze off a little bit, they rest, and they just stay very, very calm. What they'll do is they'll also shift the weight between two legs at a time. So probably lean to the left for a while, then lean to the right. Very, very peaceful scene. This is wonderful. So calm. And look, it does look like that elephant has almost dozed off slightly. They won't necessarily fall asleep completely, but they will close their eyes, they will rest. Oh, this is incredible. Very, very special. And they're not feeding, they're not doing anything other than just resting, just relaxing. And now I have seen elephants lying down before, and they do that at times, everyone, to rest and sleep. But it doesn't happen very often, but I have seen it. And you see, he's flapping his ears very slowly, and that's just helping cool the body down. It cools the blood in the ears, and as that blood circulates through the body, it regulates the temperature. So that's just what he's doing. Every now and then, just the one or two flaps. There we go. See that? Well, we had an exciting morning. We had leopard tracks. We had antelope alarm calling at what I thought was leopard. But unfortunately, no leopard. But who knows what the afternoon holds for us. I hope you've all enjoyed this morning. It really has been great. And it's been a peaceful morning, a different morning. Had some beautiful bird calls. A lot of elephant around. I know Taylor sat with some elephant, and she got to see that big elephant bull she was looking for. So who knows what the afternoon holds for us. We'll see what we can find. Thank you again to all our viewers. Really wonderful having with you on our safari with us, and hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have. And we will see you this afternoon. Don't forget to join us for our sunset safari. A big thank you to Lou and Kirsten in the final control. Thank you to Taylor and Brian, and thank you to Dave for joining me on camera this morning. Thanks, Dave.
Sure.
And we will see you all this afternoon. Enjoy your day or your evening, wherever you are in the world, everyone. Goodbye, good night. We'll see you all.